Good evening, and welcome to all our audience who is watching virtually tonight. I am so pleased to welcome you all to Gallery Lalonde, where we are hosting an exhibition of the work of Ficre Ghebreyesus. The exhibition Gate to the Blue was supposed to open in April, but everyone knows why we're opening tonight. The time that passed has been special for all of us. And tonight, you are going to have an absolutely wonderful evening listening to two luminaries, Elizabeth Alexander, a poet, a memoirist, a scholar and cultural advocate and president of the Mellon Foundation and the wife of Ficre, and Jason Moran, who is an amazing jazz innovator, an artist, an installation artist, and also was a close friend of Ficre. I would also like to say a special welcome to the family of Ficre Ghebreyesus and to Solomon and Simon, his sons, and to the Alexander family, who I believe are all watching tonight.
Okay, well, so welcome. We are here. We are here. This is a big night to have this show of Ficre's work, to be in the midst of all his work at this beautiful gallery space. And I wanted you, Jason, to come and talk with me so that we could bring Ficre a little back, more into the space with us together, and so that we could, you know, talk about the pictures that we see here, that we could have memories, that we could talk about making art and making art with all of the senses and all of the self together, which is so much a part of who Ficre was.
It is. It's about like the sensibility and of every scale, right? And the ones you honed, the ones you carry with you because someone showed you. And I wonder for you as you look around the room and also have spent the past, you know, few years really thinking about how he represented himself in this form, you know, versus within the kitchen or within the home as a father and a partner. Like looking at this work, you know, as it's kind of now, the pieces are meeting themselves again on the wall in this room, and what it feels like to walk back into this space.
Whew, I mean, it's something. Of course, you know, I was in the studio all the time with him and was seeing things as they were being made. And one of the things that's really nice about the show is that it, even in its formal composition, it replicates the way he worked, which is to say there was always a large unstretched piece like this one, Zememesh Berhe's Magic Garden, that he would be working on. And then there were medium-sized pieces, and then there were the little bitties, and then there were drawings, but it was all happening at once. So I laid eyes on everything, you know, the what we now think. I mean, I used to have my painting count of 882, but thanks to the great Bianca of Gallery Lalonde, there are more paintings, there are works on paper, there are photographs. So never did I see them like this. He eschewed framing for the most part. He was making with a fever pitch and fever pace. So to see them all like this literally feels like walking into an illuminated cavern.
Right, because something gets planted in each of the works. I mean, we always talk about this in music. We talk about, you know, the demand it takes to replay a piece. So from set to set, night to night, year to year, you play that song again. And every time you try to like smear something a bit differently, you only get a few chances to actually get it right. But in this form, you know, it's really the matter of the moment, you know, that is kind of memorialized in a way. And I thought that you know, here we are sitting in front of this piece, you know, and maybe you could take us, you know, into this piece, which I think clearly is about part of what he brings with him once he leaves Eritrea, once he gets here. How, you know, once the people who go far away, I mean, Texas is not as far as that, but once you get to the northeast of America, what do you remember about your homeland and and where are we now?
Yeah, well, so in a lot of these paintings, and in this one particular, there is the memory of the compound, the memory of the sacred space of family, the memory of space that was very much touched by his mother's aesthetic, Zema Meshberhe, a woman of uncommon grace, of uncommon quotidian fineness. The borders of that were embroidered, the colors, the baskets, the way she painted the walls, the food. I never was able to visit their home there. War and conflict interrupted all of that, but it was something he talked about all the time, and the safety that he felt within compound, but at the same time, with war always present, with a brother lost to war, sometimes the compound was infiltrated. So I think there is this attempt to remember, but again, this is not literally what the walls looked like. Right. That's not literally the shape of the window. If you could look through that window, you wouldn't see that. So that window is a painting unto itself. That window is a painting or a tapestry unto itself. That beautiful sort of weeping willow type thing is also an angel wing that we see in so many of the paintings. You know, yes, reminiscent of growing up with the incredible iconography of the Coptic Church, but also, I think, uncannily, the angel motif of someone who became an ancestor unexpectedly and too soon.
Did you all ever talk about, like, the dream state? You know, dreams he remembered. Did you all have a practice of waking up in the morning and say, oh, I have to tell you what I just dreamt? Or did that ever live between you all? Like,
what a beautiful question, and what an interesting question, because I am an avid dreamer. So I was the one who every morning was like, guess where I've been? Guess what happened? You know, wow, I saw the most extraordinary thing. And he would say, mostly, that he didn't dream, but then he would go into the studio.
Right.
And what I think is so interesting is that the paintings are not literal, even though there are finely worked representative areas. So many of them are dreamscapes. So it was almost like maybe the dreams stayed in pictures, they didn't come into words. He held them like that, but they came out when he was in his own space, as he was, you know, very, very devotedly.
Yeah, I mean, and then that kind of brings up something I was asking you earlier, which was about any good partnership. There's a lot of trading of secrets, and also the craft, the secrets of each other's craft. You know, you know, he watches you sit at a desk, you know, or wherever you write, or however you write, right? And generate, you know. You watch him in the kitchen generate, you know, you watch him walk into the studio and generate. And then sometimes then you take some of the craft across the border into a work that, you know, you're not really supposed to bring, you know, that combination of olive oils into your painting. But something that he, I think, you know, maybe in your book, what do you call him? Or does he call himself a conscious
syncretizer.
Syncretizer.
Yeah.
And you know, like this kind of like a gathering of I don't know, like if you go to art school, they teach you one practice. If you go to a music conservatory, they teach you one practice, right? If you go to a journalism school, they teach you one practice. But he seemed to be about like the multiplicity of practice and did not mind going head over heels into each one of them in a way that you rarely see in the other citizens, you know.
Yeah, I mean, I think the fact that he did so much, you know, coming as a refugee, did so much living, did so much surviving, went to art school, but as a fully grown up person, had already been a chef, had a restaurant with his brothers, had a family, had children, had been painting all along, but that I think that there was something he understood that was very precious about taking what you could as you went. And when you talk about partnership, and again, thinking about this painting that we're in front of and the magical bottle tree there, and that for both of us, I grew up, parents from Harlem, USA, as you know, grew up in Washington, D.C., didn't grow up with no bottle trees. But when I learned about the West African and then Southern coastal Black tradition of bottle trees, I became obsessed with it and thought it was an extraordinary thing to think that light and color and spirit could be caught, and that it could, this is like saying, protect this house, protect the people in it, bless the people in it. So it didn't belong to me, but I claimed it, mm-hmm. and it was from my people. And it didn't belong to his tradition, but he claimed it. But what I love there is, of course, the bottles are upside down. They're not on branches. So, you know, you take things that you think might be authentic to a tradition, but the beauty of coming together, mm-hmm. you know, and I would think often, and we would talk about, you know, here we were, two black people born at the same time, 2 months apart, completely on other sides of planet Earth. How did we find each other? I don't know. And then in bringing all of it together into the mix, that it seemed that there was an infinite amount to draw from. And that one of those things too, I didn't make pictures, he wrote some, mm-hmm. was a person of words, but also the home, the family, the children, the relationship, the food, and the music, right. and the ideas were a part of living a beautiful life where things also got made.
Yeah, yeah, it's like I often talk about the constellation, like the need for the gap between the stars, you know, the need to like to imagine the line between them so that you can actually have a vision of like, oh no, that is a line in the sky. But I think about like in you all's house, it felt like that too, but you always were drawing the line between parenthood, between partnership, between a writing practice, between a cooking practice. And so in your home, it felt much like, I think I imagine great institutional spaces can feel like a real home where all of the communities kind of lie together only in the practice of the people who live in the space themselves. Mm-hmm. And you all's house, I guess, you know, part of, I guess one of the first visits we made up to New York or up to New Haven was for Juneteenth.
Yes.
And but then I think he took me into the backyard to show me, you know, like, oh, this is kind of where I work. Mm-hmm. And walking into this space, and I guess, as you know, like the paintings are seem like they're of a period of time, you know. And if you could kind of chart that, you know, maybe the era of this work, you know.
Yeah, that's a great question, and these paintings come from different periods of time. It's interesting that they feel the same, but all of them come, so now that we've had the chance with our friends at Lelong to look at, you know, so in the studio that he had, you were first in the garage in back of the house, which he turned into a home studio, and then there was the other studio, which was in Erector Square, and after he passed away in 2012, we kept the work in that space because it was organized, it was cataloged, and we held our breath for 8 years, but it was safe, you know, and then finally got it out, finished getting it out shortly before the pandemic, which feels very fortunate, and then have had very, very powerful time with Lindsay and Mary and Bianca and Mele looking at the work and putting it into dated order, and rely, because sometimes he didn't sign it, sometimes he didn't date it. He very much had and you probably heard us have this argument at some point because we had it quite regularly, you know, it's like, ka-cha, sell that work, brother. Why are you keeping these treasures? But his idea was like, I'm just making work, baby. You know, let me make this work. So it was almost like, I think, you know, he had a healthy artist's ego and sense of vision and sense of self. But I also think that the name itself and the idea of soul authorship was not the most important thing to him. So the process of putting things in chronological order, which I do think is important to understand development and to see, okay, when does the work, because it's true, a lot of the earlier work is, it's much darker because for him, his place of resolution was coming into family. And so I think that that's also a very interesting thing with you as well, being deeply in family, being deeply in an artistic partnership, mm-hmm. as it turns out, is the place where you're also able to be a very productive artist.
Mm, yeah. And be constantly challenged as well by your partner.
Constantly challenged.
I wanted to ask you kind of about, you know, like titles of pieces, you know, yes. which I always think is like a really, you know, was part of the clue for the viewer or part of the clue, but Seated Musician, you know, Red Hats and Balloons. Oh my goodness. Yeah, Seated Musician and Feathered Wing, you know. Mm-hmm. Like our, you know, I'm Gate to the Compound, which we'll eventually go see as
yes.
well. But you know, like talk about this language part of, you know, adding language to the piece.
Yeah, well that was something that we sometimes did together, and that was very collaborative because again, I was always showing him my poems and showing them before, and we very much had a practice of he would say, come look at the paintings, and he'd get mad sometimes if I was like, you know,
right.
There's still just like if I said like, I'm so excited, I've written this poem, and he'd be like, but once something was done, the naming process was pleasure. Mm. So some of the best names were names that we made together. Some of the other ones that are more literally descriptive, along with the help of Kijo Lee, who's a wonderful, wonderful art historian, who was a graduate student at Yale at the time, and helped completely, you know, catalog and put things in order, and is now at the Cleveland Museum. She said, like, we gotta give, everything's gotta be called something.
Mm-hmm.
So together we went through that.
Oh, wow.
Process.
Mm-hmm.
For something like this, Zemamesh Berhe's Magic Garden, what it meant to have his mother's name in a painting this made after she had passed,
mm-hmm.
And thinking about, you know, I think there are many, 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 many references, as with anybody, but what I think is really interesting is some of the artists or musicians or things he was obsessed with, you wouldn't necessarily see them. So I wouldn't necessarily say this looks like a Bearden, but all of those incredible watercolory Bearden gardens are in here. And so Maudel Sleet's Magic Garden, that Bearden work, is one that's underneath this one, and some of the other gardens and compounds.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's like everyone has multiple memories in it too. I mean,
we can walk. Let's
shall
walk.
We?
Yeah,
yeah.
Shall we? Yes. Actually, and before we go to Gate to the Compound, I want to just take a second at this one. Tis time to seek asylum. I wonder if you had any time thinking about this one before.
I mean, here we are. but also I think about, you know, what we talked about earlier, which was the title of the exhibition, Gate to the Blue itself. What blue means, you know, what it has always meant for us, you know,
mm-hmm.
what it always has meant for, also for North Africa as a healing color. Mm-hmm. And also in the time when when many musicians, I'm talking about artists, you know, now who can't reach a public, who can't reach a kind of freedom that they access through their instrument, meeting people, you know, that these kinds of things, also that there's you're also supposed to find comfort in this kind of reclusive state.
Mm-hmm.
for me, this is like, oh, now I'm ready to jump inside it.
Mm-hmm.
Rather than a thing that we also kind of resist, a kind of aloneness, but over the past 7 months, it's been a thing that, even though it's been with my family, it is a place to feel, a wall to, like a wall to kind of like place your body against, you know, all of these places that also, you know, I mean, now we also think about people who are inside, the inside, who can't also get out. You know, what is at the top?
I quite make out what it is, but I think that's so interesting to see it in this moment, because of course there's also, you know, the idea of political asylum, being a refugee, what it means, an idea of the United States as a safe place, has gotten so politically distorted and complicated. Mm-hmm. And then again, all of these, I love that you mentioned, you know, blue is a healing color, and thinking about, you know, when Albert Murray said, who, you know, as you know, named Bearden's paintings, and when Albert Murray talked about the blues as such, that, you know, he was, Ficre actually did like the U.S. Delta blues. Mm-hmm. He listened to a lot of that, but he also was obsessed with Ali Farka Touré.
Right.
You know, and he also was obsessed with deep blue tones and sounds and notes and gutturals, like we were talking about earlier about, you know, Tigrinya and the shapes in the throat that make it possible, that are very, very, very hard to make when you're a grown-up person, if you haven't come up speaking that way. But the language holds something from here, something visceral.
Yeah, it does. Yes, it does. I was going to say that, thinking about Howlin' Wolf, like thinking about people who also use like the stretch of the vocal cord as like, actually, no, this is my beautiful place in my voice. You know, it's not the thing to like try to clear up for you, but actually I sink it down in there with all the friction of my chords together, that you hear that, you know,
like,
we think about Miles Davis, we think about Louis Armstrong, we, you know, think about Billie Holiday's slide of those words. And it becomes also the place where that is kind of like, it's fitting for it to sit inside that space. And we haven't talked much about how he listened, which is a major part of the practice, you know, how he listened as he makes these works, you know, the kinds of sounds he's infatuated with, curious, you know, the sounds he brings with him into his workspace. Maybe we go to the compound.
Let's go to the compound. Let's go to the gate to the compound. Yeah, so you start.
Well, I'm glad the gate is open. this is where we started today. I asked you to walk me through. And also I asked about why it was titled Gate of the Blue. And that led us into our conversation about the blues, but I also was really also kind of asking about this technique here, you know, and also, and you started to also break open for us the forms at the top and the officers there,
it's, you know, as you said, the gate is open, and inside there's not what you would expect. There's not the family home, but rather there are much more ancient structures. There are much more, they would be called vernacular structures, but, you know, so if you look about, and he was very interested in an architectural form called the hudmo. This isn't exactly the hudmo, but he studied it in the village where his family was from. But then this also, you know, these are pass-throughs. So there's also something that's sort of like a Roman, you know, kind of figure in there. And then you have that factory-like building in the corner with what I think is the Bearden plume of Pittsburgh smoke. but what's happened with the open gate to the compound is that the soldiers have broken in. So that was a motif, something that happened in childhood. That soldiers broke into the compound, that soldiers broke into the home, and that his astonishing mother, that the boys hid, and his astonishing mother talked them out, willed them out, got them out.
Wow.
And so, you know, you see that there. So this space that you want to be safe is viable, but you are interested in all of this, that, you know, the texture, the scraping, the flowers, the magic, the portal that doesn't act, is not permeable to inside. It's like a magic window. And then I think that's our bottle tree, but our bottle tree is bare. You know, the home is not protected, maybe, I don't know. And then what I think is also really fascinating in all of the blues, in the gate to the blue, that here's this impossible moat. You know, here's this water that is doing an impossible thing, and that has, and what moves me, of course, a lot, is that this was someone who was making paintings while being a very encompassing and exquisite father.
Right, yes.
I mean...
Yeah, those boys, I mean, any child really challenges the path of an artist. Because you have to take them into account.
Yeah.
At any moment that you got any free time to make anything, you can't help but bring their joy or their whatever trauma they're going through in their 10-year-old lives into the work too, whether you want to or not. You know, like the Fats Waller dance party that you all came to was actually made for those kids. It was that they could come to a show and just wild out on the dance floor and nobody would get mad. So it was actually made for those kids. And in Ficre's work, it always seems that there are these kind of like these places for the boys, you know, which you were pointing out earlier, which was in his paper hat boat.
Paper hat boat. That's right.
Yeah, but these spaces also offer. The reason I asked about the dream part is because you aren't necessarily, and not just as an artist, but I think as a viewer, we aren't supposed to kind of bring our kind of like, okay, Manhattan looks like this, and now I walk into here and I should see it. But you're here to let go of all of that, you know? You're here to stand in front of a work that helps you let go. I also wondered when you were talking about him as a, you know, dealing with, you know, his mother kind of taking a stand, you know, how old was he when this happened?
That is a good question. I would think a young teenager. I would think a young teenager, so old enough of a young man that there would be, you know, the fear that a young man could be conscripted or taken.
Did he talk about that with his sons?
You know, that's really interesting. They were 12 and 13, so he was, when he died, he was whole self with them, but I don't, every story wasn't shared, you know, because some stories you don't share with children. Many were, and living with those stories and giving them over in the 8 years that have passed has been an interesting thing.
Yeah, and these pieces, they end up becoming like the journal.
That's
for
right.
For all of, you know, for you, him, them and everyone else to be able to kind of address themselves in too. Yeah, but these pieces, and I guess when people hopefully get to visit the show, they'll see what the narrative of this is.
Yes.
That long form blues.
Yeah, long form blues. I like that.
Yeah, it's longer than 12 bars. I mean, you know, like, and because there's more opportunity, and kind of like when you said the impossibility of water, it more felt like the possibility of water, which is our most, like, you know, free form that we have. At least a musician always asks that they feel more like that, you know, so that they can kind of get inside of every part of a sound, of a song, of a chord, of a groove, you know, that water allows that more freely, you know, as a person who sits inside of a groove. So it's also what this means, you know, when you talk about like it as a moat, but it's also like the thing that's keeping it, like, it's not only trying to fill in the void, but it's like shoring it up too. Like here is the space.
I love that. I love that. What do you think about? I'm thinking about time, and the intensity with which he made these paintings, and the a certain kind of simplicity of life. You know, we lived in New Haven. We lived in our home. The studio was, you know, either in the backyard or it was a mile away. I taught a mile away. The kids went to school a couple blocks away. You remember walking over to the house. Things had a certain simplicity which made for lots and lots and lots of time to work. And I think about even the days, I miss those days, like the days when we became friends, where, you know, a stranger emailed a stranger and said, like, y'all want to come for Juneteenth? We had never had a Juneteenth party before, but we said, well, like, we're going to make new friends. Yeah. Let's have a Juneteenth
party. That's also a very parent thing to do, like, oh, wait a minute, these kids cannot be my life.
That's right. But those days were long.
Right. They were. And, you know, passage of time, I guess, also for artists who work in a space, I also really am curious about, like, playlists people bring into a space that they create with, because it's, you know, musicians often talk about, like, documenting the time. You know, some people, you know, were famous for making 7 records in a year and a half.
Yeah, in the 60s.
It was that kind of, like, rapid entry to the studio with a new body of work that people were producing. And thinking about Ficre, like, really kind of like, okay, I have all of this stuff to do in this 24-hour period, right? But also I have to make space and time to do this, to make sure that it's documented this way. Like, just like, you know, I really think of it like that journal practice that continues to keep it there rather than resist the urge and say, oh, I'll get to it. You more had it like,
I'm doing it. Yeah, no, that's right. And actually, it's interesting when you look at the span of time in which the work was made. Like with any artist, any musician, any poet, there are different stages. I mean, I always like that in teaching. If I'm teaching writing, I say, okay, now go listen to every, you know, what musician do you love the most? Listen to every single thing they recorded. Everything. Or what artist do you love? You know, go look at an entire retrospective. Learn one artist not in your art form from beginning to end. Because then what you will see is it's not like, you know, I make a painting every 6 weeks and it's even like that. And then also that's where you can see people obsessive trying to work something out, stuck in a groove. Coming back to, you know, how you hear it in musicians, like, oh yeah, that riff, heard that before, but you're working something out. Oh, and here we are in 11. So you want to talk about this diptych?
Yeah, well, we were talking about the diptychs earlier. You know, you were talking about, like, finding one and not knowing that there was a bottom half, you know. I was always asked these questions about diptychs, about how the artist imagined them in the first place, you know. You know, is this a stanza break? You know, like, what does it mean to break something into two or to consider it one? The form always has that in it. And this, the name of this piece is.
This isn't the feathered hat. This is.
Seated musician with feathered wing.
Yeah. There's a lot of them to remember. I think what I think is really interesting about the diptychs is that if he'd wanted this not to have this stanza break, then he might have made it align absolutely precisely. But there's just that little bit of torque. There's like that bit of light, that bit of energy, that bit of like unreconciled self, that bit of not tidying it up, though it's a very carefully made work. And I mean, I think in making art, certainly in poems,
the poems that tie up tidily at the end are usually not the best ones, you know? So sometimes I would say, back when I taught poems, you know, like just chop off the end, torque it, open it, and see how you get an energy, a life force. Because of course, like, and this is, it's a great comfort to me, but it's very powerful to me, like, this is DNA. You know, this is made by a living creature. We're now sitting here, you know, usually in masks. This is something with breath in it. When you look up close, I mean, these paintings are so amazing in the big room. And then when you look up close and you think about someone making and detailing, you know?
Yeah.
And then this drum, this is a drum. So at our wedding, there's a kind of blue, maybe Mele knows this. What is the blue can that's made into the drum? It's turquoise. Okay. but there's a blue about this long can. I don't know what it might once have been because it's a very particular turquoise that's made into a drum that goes around the neck. And that's hit with a stick. And so I like that in so many of these paintings there are Eritrean instruments, all of which he played.
Right.
Did he ever play the krar, that little kind of like lyre?
Okay.
That's in one of the paintings, but he could play that very nicely. Yeah. And thought they were beautiful objects and sometimes would paint instruments, you know.
This is a great piece.
The first question is from Professor Gates, who asks if Ficre would be happy to be taught in a course on African American artists or African artists or both.
Superb question. So New Haven, Connecticut, you know, Ficre lived in New Haven, Connecticut longer than he lived anywhere. And before he came to the United States via Sudan, via Italy, via Germany, U.S. black culture was very much in his imagination. Some of it was having older sisters, one of whom, his sister Mehrat, went to Hampton and had, you know, kind of a lot of black soul sounds from the 70s as part of the records. And there are, I was telling Jason, there are these turntable paintings. He was really interested in records. And the records also that his even older siblings used to play Sam Cooke, Let's Twist Again. You know, they would dance to that kind of music too. Angela Davis and her politics, James Brown, you know, all of these black American and diasporic, you know, Bob Marley, these diasporic black figures were what he belonged to in his imagination. Even when he was a child in Eritrea. So, I mean, I think what was kind of amazing about what I found amazing was all of these things, all of these blacknesses were true at the same time. So he would never not be Asmarino, someone from Asmara, someone from Eritrea, someone from East Africa. That's the deep and ancestral self. But he became a black man. Living in New Haven, Connecticut, with like a super black wife and black children, but all of it true at once. So the answer to the lovely question is, I think that you know, to be African American is many, many, many different things. To be diasporically black is many different things. To be African is so many different things. To be East African is so many different things. So I think all the contexts work.
Okay, so the second question, I don't know if it's more complicated, but it's about boats. Mm-hmm. So someone asked if you could speak about his relationship to boats.
Well, you see in this show, and they'll see the little movie afterwards, there are all kinds of boats in this show. So some of them, we're looking over at the boats with balloons over there, are what I would call magical boats, these you know, boats with balloons with these beautiful creatures in it. And then we talked about the paper hat toy boat. And then there are two instances where named the Amistad ship, that ship with stolen West Africans that grounded in New Haven, where the famous trial, and we were both obsessed with the Amistad. We lived in New Haven. We knew that the Amistad captives were let out on the New Haven Green for their exercise. The famous trial took place there. I wrote an epic poem about the Amistad, and a replica of the Amistad came back to live in New Haven when we were there in the early 2000s. So the Amistad ship and the idea of the middle passage, you know, that if we go look over there, that that these middle passage boats were a way that these black people who he identified with had been stolen and brought to this place where he now lived. There's that idea of the boat.
The boat at night.
The boat at night. That kind of dark, and it's interesting because I think those structures in the background look like what we see in some of his earlier paintings, paintings that were made out of his time teaching in a war zone in Eritrea. Mm-hmm. But that boat would not have been there. So what I think is very interesting about all of this is that he was not someone who grew up around water. He was not someone who swam, who you know was an avid swimmer. He was a Highlander. So the boats are real. The boats are historical. The boats are invented, and they are all of those different things. I think if we're going to talk about boats, also we should just look at the reflected boats, of which there are so many. If we can. Is it too much to go over here? because this is one of the reflected boats. And there are a number of, they're, I think, very beautiful. And what I, and then there were boats that he painted and saw in New England. I mean, in Maine and in New Haven. But here, these, what I think is interesting is they're boats, but there is no boat that I know of that is colored like that, shaped like that, and it's reflecting differently. And it has a sort of basketness to it. And he was very, very interested in those shapes, which I think borrowed from other vessels and figures.
So Bianca and Lindsay. So let us say in another culture that I've worked, when someone has gone, you say the name and then presente, you know, like the person
presente.
So, you know, so Ficre, we feel, is here. Elizabeth, you are here. Simon, Solo, you are here, even though you're online. And thank you for the gift of working with this amazing legacy. And thank you, Jason, for sharing all your insights tonight. It was very moving. And Grace, Mycroft, everyone, Millay, thank you. Lindsay, you are a treasure. And Bianca, you cataloged 1,000 works over the summer. So, to Ficre, cheers.
Cento anni. Ficre. Cheers.
Thank you all for joining us tonight.
Could I add one thing?
Yeah, sure. If there's enough battery.
If there's enough battery, I just want to echo thanks to everyone at Lelong. At Mary, you saw, and the ways that you and Lindsay and Bianca have learned this work, understood this work, treasured this work, taken care of this work, repaired this work, rescued this work, and now speak for this work I don't have enough words for what that means to me. And Mellay, my darling niece, who has been my true comrade in bringing this work to others. Mele was a gift that her uncle gave to me quite explicitly when I met her as a 10-year-old or something like that. It's like, oh, you come with extraordinary, brilliant little girls. Surely I will marry you. And Jason, just for being a brother and for being a fellow traveler and for understanding so much so deeply. Thank you. We're standing in front of Mangia Libro, a good place to end. Mangia Libro was Ficre's childhood nickname. It means book eater. So to the most curious, learned, fascinating, beautiful, soulful treasure of a human being I have ever met, that is him in this dream world, and we are in this dream world too. So thank you. Cheers.